Hey everybody, good to see you. Thank you so much for joining me and welcome to the July 2021 Quilted Joy Clubhouse episode. We are delighted that you are here and I appreciate you spending some time with me. We've got a lot of great things for you planned. I was thinking today, we've been doing 2021 as the year of the grid, so focusing on grid quilting. And so we're halfway through the year. It doesn't hardly seem possible, but we have brought you many different things to think about so far, and I hope that you have signed up for our newsletter, because in our newsletter, you can get, there are downloadable worksheets that we include with the newsletter that go hand in hand with things that we talk about here on the Clubhouse, that you can print them out at home and you can kind of play along. So those get sent out. We do a weekly newsletter, and we also include lots of fun things. Like this morning, if you got our newsletter, I hope you saw at the bottom, there were some fun links. And one was like how to crochet like an overlay of granny squares, which is not what I would have called them, but truly my granny crocheted these squares, but granny squares on a tennis shoe. And it's so fun. I don't know how to crochet, I don't know how to knit, but if I did, I would totally make those shoes because they were adorable. So it was a link to show you how to do that. So I hope that you're on our newsletter list. We try to really give you lots of fun things as well as informational content and let you know what's going on here at the shop at Quilted Joy in Louisville, Kentucky. And if you are ever traveling through Kentucky or to Louisville, we would love to have you stop in. We actually had a group this morning come in from Colorado and stop by and say hello, and I think there was one from Minnesota yesterday. So we do get to see folks and we enjoy it. So make sure that you are on our newsletter list. And then we are also having a summer sale on our Glide thread. We have our King Cones marked down to $8.99. And we have a bunch of interesting bundles for you as well. So if you are interested in grabbing some thread, head over to quiltedjoy.com. And you don't need a coupon code or anything. It's just sitting there waiting for you to take advantage of it at $8.99 for that King Cone. And then we do have the Mini Cones as well, if you prefer that. And the mini cones, Jesse, remind me, are how much per? $3.25 for the mini cones. So head over there, and if you use it, we use Glide here for machine quilting, but I also use it for machine embroidery. There's lots of applications for it. So if you haven't tried it yet, pick up like a white cone or something you know you're gonna use and see what you think about it. I think you'll enjoy Glide. And speaking of that, we do have our limited edition thread pack for July, and that is Santa and Sunshine, because you know Santa's on the beach somewhere, trying not to think too much about his to-do list. And those three colors are Sultry, Flint, and Viridian. And I love those color combinations. That it really kind of sparks some joy to see them. So I hope that you go over and check those out on the website. That's our limited edition. Once that pack is gone, it won't be offered again. So grab it while you can. All right, so we have been talking all this year about our little ladybug friend. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, you're like, what are you talking about, ladybug friend? Go back and watch some of the other 2021 Clubhouse meetings, and you will find our little ladybug has been super busy. Our little ladybug travels through our house, our grid, travels through each room of our house, again, portions of our grid, and she does little things in each house. And it's just a way that I have found to teach grid quilting that kind of breaks down that big concept into something more approachable, something a little smaller, and hopefully it's something that resonates with you. And I can't wait to show you later on. We had a gal post a photo of what she did with her ladybug, and I've got it in our show and tell at the end of this Clubhouse meeting, and I can't wait to show you what she did, because I just love it. But anyway, we are gonna talk about our ladybug. And our ladybug has been doing all kinds of things. Our ladybug has been on a high dive. Our ladybug has been doing cursive writing. And today, our ladybug is gonna hop on a roller coaster. And I don't mean like a small kiddie coaster. I mean a big adult, grown-up, scare you to death, first hill, deep dive roller coaster. So that's really the key. Don't think about a kiddie roller coaster. That's, you know, just kind of a small first hill. We're talking about a massive first hill. And I tell you, I was trying to think too this morning, like the last time I've been on a roller coaster, and it's been a while, so I'm gonna have to figure out a way to fix that because I really enjoy roller coasters, but it has been a little while. I think the last one was Universal, if I remember correctly, which was a couple years back before COVID. So let's talk about our ladybug. And the first thing I wanna do is I just wanna draw you her path so that you understand this first hill, this grown-up roller coaster hill. So I've got a blank screen here, and I just wanna show you how our ladybug is gonna travel. So she's gonna go big hill, and then she slides in. And that's really the path. So it's a grown-up roller coaster hill, right? It's got a tall first hill. And of course, we have to have our ladybug going in all different directions. So she may go this way. She may big hill slide in, go upside down. She may go big hill slide in down this way. She may go this way. So you're gonna have to draw this big hill slide in all different directions, because if you are using, even if you were using a sit-down machine, you wouldn't wanna turn your quilt every time your ladybug goes on a different hill. It's gonna be easier for you if you can keep that quilt fairly stationary so that you can do your ladybug. Now, if you're on a stand-up machine, of course, you don't get a choice. You have to do it right side up, upside down, et cetera, et cetera. All right, so we're gonna put our little ladybug, who's on a roller coaster, on this. I have a 9-patch grid here, and I am gonna zoom in. And by the way, I always get asked, like, what program am I using? This is GIMP, G-I-M-P. It's just a free graphics program. You probably already have a graphics program on your computer if you wanted to draw on your computer. This one is free. You can get it off the internet, and there's a lot of tutorials out there, so if you wanna learn it, it's kinda easy to learn. Okay, so here's our ladybug house. It's a 9-patch. Here's the first level of our house, right? The top level of our house. Here's one room, two rooms, three rooms of the top level of our house. Here's the middle level of our house. Again, there's three rooms. And the bottom level of our house. Again, there's three rooms. So our little ladybug is gonna be up here in the attic, and she's gonna come out of the attic, and she's going to get on her roller coaster. Now, she's gonna go across the ceiling of this first room. So in our eyes, she's upside down. Of course, if you're a ladybug, there is no right side or wrong side. You defy gravity, so it doesn't matter, right? So we're gonna do a big hill and slide in. Now she's hit this wall of our house, big hill, slide in. And if you've been watching, we're gonna go up this wall into the second room of our house. If you've been watching some of our other clubhouse meetings, this path is familiar to you because this is the path she's been taking through our house the whole time. She's just doing different things on the path. So now we're gonna go across the ceiling, big hill, slide in, down this wall, big hill, slide in, and back up the wall, ceiling, wall, and now she's hit the floor. And now we're gonna go across the floor, 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 and now she's ready to drop down into the middle level of our house. Really make sure you kick out and make those big swoops, because those big swoops are going to allow the eye to kind of glaze over any of your imperfections as you stitch this, so that the eye isn't gonna see all of those symmetrical changes. Now we're gonna go into the bottom level of our house. We're gonna start with this first room, big hill slide in, big hill slide in, big hill slide in. And if you are on our newsletter list, you got a blank grid so that you can practice this in front of the TV and make your family wonder what the heck you're doing. At this point, they probably know what you're doing. They probably go, oh, she's doodling again. I know, she's practicing her quilting. Okay, so we reach the bottom level of our house. And at this point, I have spotted Miss Ladybug on her roller coaster, and I am after her. So now she's gonna go and she's gonna hide up in the attic. Hide up in the attic. So that is the ladybug on a roller coaster shape that we are gonna talk about. And I did wanna show you quickly, if we were to put that, you know, we did it on a 9-patch. But you could easily do the same thing on a border design. And I'm just gonna do a few of these and I'm gonna just start here. So I'm gonna start big hill, slide in, and I'm gonna do, let's see, I'm gonna do big hill, slide in, big hill, slide in, big hill, slide in, big hill, slide in. And literally that is going on in my brain, because if I don't have something going on in my brain, then I start thinking about groceries or something. So big hill, slide in. All right, I'm not gonna keep going. I'm gonna head on back. Big hill, slide in. So we took this grid design and we put it as a single layer in a block on a border. But you could also stack that and have like a two-story house in your border, and it would give you a little bit more of a flow that I think you'd like. All right, let's quilt this out on our APQS Millie. And I've got a grid here chalked out. I'm not sure that you can see it all that well on camera. You can see it? Okay, good. And Kelsey, the camera's pointed okay?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. And if you have any questions, pop them there in the chat and Jesse will let me know what your questions are. But let's start with the first room of the top level of our house. Our Ladybug comes out, big hill, slide in. And this is a great thing to practice on like a fabric panel. If you can just mark out a grid, even on just some like solid quilt fabric, this is a really nice little beginner way to kind of start thinking about how to break down a space into a smaller space for free motion quilting. And what I love about this is that I don't have to pick up a ruler. I don't have to be perfect. My little ladybug has character. I'm headed up to the attic and it stitches out beautifully. It's forgiving to both the piecer and to the quilter. So it's really one of my absolute favorite designs. All right, I'm gonna cut my threads and then I'm gonna hold that thread, that you can see how that stitches out. And I've done this in one of our glide metallic threads. Well, it's not metallic, you know, it's polyester, but it has a metallic look to it. So like the Dijon color especially looks like a gold that's really pretty on a like a Christmas holiday quilt with this design on it. Just break up the spaces that you have. Think about the spaces that you have and how you can create a grid from them. You can do it in a border, you can do it in a sashing, you can do it in just a block that you don't know what the heck to do with it, because of course all of our blocks are built on grids, so it all works together. So I hope that you like that and I hope that you try it. And if you try it, pop over into the Quilted Joy Clubhouse over on Facebook and put a picture of it so we can all cheer you on and see your progress. I always love to see what you're working on, and I especially love it if you take something that we've talked about here in the Clubhouse and show me how you've applied it in your little world, because that is helpful to me to know that, you know, we're connecting and what we're doing is helpful for you. Okay, I want to thank our sponsor, APQS. APQS machines are 100% handcrafted in Iowa. They're loved the world over, and they come with a lifetime warranty. And with APQS machines, you can quilt forever. We are having a roadshow here in Louisville on August the 14th, so if you are in the market for a long arm machine, you can register for that. There's no charge. It's specifically for folks who are interested in gathering information because they're kind of trying to learn more about long arm machines and which one they might select. So if you want any information about that, give us a ring or send us an email and we'd be happy to chat with you more. Of course, you can also connect with your local APQS dealer or your local APQS store for more information, or visit APQS.com to learn more about APQS long arms. Thanks, APQS. All right, we have a great looky-loo tour to show you today. This is Courtney. And Kelsey, remind me, where is Courtney located?
In Bowling Green,
Kentucky. It's always so funny because we talk to people and I always presume that they're like, you know, 8 hours away from us. They're like, no, we're, you know, Bowling Green's what, an hour and 45 minutes away. So Courtney was kind enough to spend a little time with us and to show us around her studio, and I can't wait for you to see it.
Hi, Courtney. Welcome. Hello. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, tell me where you are right now. What city are you in?
I'm in Bowling Green, Kentucky.
Perfect. So you are about 2 hours, I guess, a little southwest of me because I'm in Louisville.
Yep.
Yeah, awesome. Well, so you have been quilting for quite some time. You told me you've been quilting since you were 10?
Yep. Yeah, I started making doll quilts because my mom was a quilter. So I started
That's
doing
awesome.
Doll quilts when I was about 10.
That's awesome. All right. Well, I can't wait to see your space. So can you go ahead and turn it around and let's see what's going on in your studio? Oh my goodness. Is that your design wall?
Yes.
So what did you make that of?
I saw it on someone else's sewing room tour. They're like acoustic sound dampening panels.
Oh.
So they're just nailed to the wall and then you can pin into them. So I wanted a really big design wall. I had always had really small ones, so I really wanted a larger one. And this was an easier way to do it. So it wasn't too hard to put up. You just nail them in and you got a design wall.
Well, and those are gorgeous quilts in progress. That's not for the same quilt, is it? Those are two different quilts you're working on?
Yeah, I can't work on one thing.
Yeah, I hear you. All right, so show us what else is in there.
Okay, so then this is my fabric storage.
So
I've got just a couple bookshelves. Yep.
So you're in your home? Are you at on the top floor or bedroom?
Yep. The top floor they called it a bonus room and then a bedroom. So I took over the whole top floor for my sewing space.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect. So you get your books.
Yep. My books and all my fabric are there.
Uh-huh.
And it's just kind of like a weird little hallway. So there wasn't much else I could put there.
Perfect.
And this is my sewing area. So I have my cutting table.
Did you build that cutting table?
No, I got it off another Facebook group. It was an idea. It's two workbenches. So they're two workbenches I got at Tractor Supply and just put them together and it makes it really nice. So you see they're like back to back. So
right. Oh, that
really
is
a nice large cutting table.
And it looks super sturdy too.
Oh yes. It's it's not going anywhere. It's pretty heavy.
Yeah. The pegboard, did you paint it? What are the,
I wanted it to look prettier. So I painted the pegboard. That's where I usually just keep my rulers hanging up there.
Yeah.
Kind of store the quilts I finished.
Oh, that's a beautiful way to store them too.
Yeah. I wanted to have them up here.
Yeah. I love that. And there's your puppy dog.
They're always up here. They're used to being up here with me. So that's my ironing board.
Yeah.
I have it on another shelf. And then this is my scrap storage.
Perfect.
So I have it sorted by color. The little pull-out bins. That's worked very well.
And those are just like those closet organizers.
Yeah, from IKEA.
Yeah.
They're just some IKEA drawers. So they really
work well for. What's on the top? Is it a... it looks thick.
What
is it? Just like
that's just stuff I'm working on.
But that looks like a thick top to the closet organizer. Is that actually what it looks like?
Yeah, these are just shelves that IKEA sold. So it's all
perfect
IKEA pieces. So I wanted to have a top on it. It's actually two of them because I used to have it stacked.
Okay.
Four across, so that was big enough to cover the four. But in this
Got
space.
It.
I've moved a lot, so this has traveled with me to many, many different sewing spaces.
Awesome.
So that's its current setup.
And then?
There's my piecing table.
Fabulous.
Lots of IKEA stuff.
Yeah.
It has this little, you probably can't see it now, but that little piece pulls in and out so I can push it.
Oh, yeah.
So if I don't need it, it's out of the way, but it's kind of nice to have for cutting and
sewing. You have a light board there. Are you using that because you're paper piecing or do you used to have that all the time there?
I usually just leave it there. That's kind of its home, but I love it for paper piecing.
Sure.
It's really helped a lot with paper piecing.
Yeah. And then more storage.
Yep. More storage, just more drawers.
Yeah. Okay.
And then in this other room is where the long arm lives.
Oh, I see. So the bonus room and the bedroom that you were talking about, both you've got them incorporated.
Yes. I used to have a long arm out here,
uh-huh.
but I didn't like it in here so much. So recently I took over the bedroom as the long arm space and I had to take the closet out so it would fit in here.
Oh yeah.
it is in here. So have a Lucy.
A Lucy. And is it a 12-foot Lucy, a 10-foot Lucy?
12-foot.
A 12 foot. So show me where the closet was that you had to take out the doors.
This wall, the whole wall was a closet.
Oh, you took out the wall.
I'm in here. So I took down the closet wall.
Right. Yeah.
Now the long arm fits in here.
Perfect. And so you can stand there and look out the window as you sew.
Yep.
Fantastic. Fantastic. And you like those. Uh-huh. Yeah, you have two of those, don't you?
Yeah, I have lots. Yeah. I like IKEA.
Yeah.
I have a lot of IKEA items.
Yeah.
And then I just have that cabinet as well. I just keep the quilts waiting to be quilted in there and like backing and things.
Perfect. So where do you keep all of the thread? Because I know you have more thread than you had on that pegboard.
I don't have a ton yet. I haven't been machine quilting for that long. So I just have a couple baskets in here.
Okay.
So my thread is in these two baskets.
Got it. So how long have you been long arm quilting? You've been quilting since you were 10, but how long have you been long arm quilting?
I've had the long arm, I think 4 years now.
Okay.
So I'm still getting into it since I just quilt for myself.
Uh-huh.
So it's just my quilts I'm doing. So I haven't had enough practice on it yet, but I'm getting there.
Perfect. Yeah. Well, you certainly found the space that you need. And you've got a little, a great studio there with individual rooms for the piecing and then a room for the quilting process and a very happy puppy dog.
Yes.
Oh, look at them. They're like, what are we doing, Mom? Yep. That's great. Well, can you turn the camera around so we can see you, Courtney? I want to know some things. So can you tell me three things that you would recommend to your bestie? They don't have to be quilt related, but what are three things that are kind of lighting you up right now?
Right now, the number one thing, I can't get in the camera, is my garden.
Yeah.
Now that it's spring here, I spend a lot of time in the garden. I'm out there more than I am in the sewing space right now. So that would be my number one thing.
Yeah.
I love that. And then I recently got a Peloton. So
Peloton. Oh, I love
Peloton. I love getting to get that exercise in, especially with COVID and everything. I've had to change up a lot of my normal routine. So that's been real helpful.
Perfect. Yeah. And your third thing?
My third thing.
You said something about avocados. Yes. Tell me about avocados.
I'm not much of a cook, but I love avocado. And I found they have little cups of pre-cut up avocado that's already smushed up. So if you just want some avocado toast or something, you don't have to worry about picking perfect avocados. You can just buy these little cups of avocado. So that's been pretty great.
Yum. Yeah. If only we lived in a climate that we could grow avocados, right?
that would be nice.
Yeah. I see pictures. People have like lemon trees out their backyard. They go pick a lemon. And I think, oh my gosh, if only that would be fantastic.
So
that would be so good. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for sharing your space with us today, Courtney. And I really appreciate the time. You have a gorgeous studio and I can see that you are tweaking things and finding out what suits you best. And you have created a great little space there for yourself.
Thank you.
Yeah. So we'll see you in the clubhouse. Okay.
Great. Thank you.
All right. See ya.
Thank you so much, Courtney. I really appreciate you giving us a look at your space, and it's always fun to see what's going on, and I love your little doggies. So thanks for all of your time, and I hope that you pop over into the Quilted Joy Clubhouse and thank Courtney as well. It's always so much fun to see somebody's space and see how they have it organized. So I appreciate it. And if you would like to show us around your studio, I would love to set up a video chat with you as well. You can actually go into the Quilted Joy Clubhouse and we'll post a link there after we get done here that'll take you to where you can put your information in so that you can give us some ideas about what time and day would be great for you. We just do it on your cell phone and record it. And if you mess up or flub or your dog, takes over the show, that actually is great. But if you would like to, restart, we can all do that and make everybody feel comfortable. So I would love it if you would raise your hand and say that you'll let me be nosy in your studio. I'm always looking for an opportunity to be nosy. So there you go. All right, we do have some new items that just walked in the door here at the Quilted Joy Shop, and they are some wide back fabrics for those Christmas quilts, Christmas in July, right? So I just want you to see, these are Studio E fabrics, and there are multiple colorways. So take a look at this one. It's red and it's got some gold swirls. Aren't the snowflakes pretty? So that one is the red colorway. I'm upside down?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Whew. How can you tell?
It looked funky.
Oh, okay. All right. I was like, the snowflakes kind of look the same, Kelsey. Okay, there's the red and the gold and the white. And then here's the navy blue. Isn't that beautiful? With the rich blues and the swirls and the white snowflakes. And then there's like a frozen icy blue with those snowflakes and the swirls. But I think my favorite is this one. The gray with the little pops of red and the swirls. Doesn't that make you just wanna go listen to some Christmas music and start piecing your Christmas quilt? Love that. So if you're interested in those are new in the shop. You can find them at quiltedjoy.com. And these are 108 inches wide. So they are for the back of a quilt made by Studio E. And what's the line called?
Frozen Melodies.
Frozen Melodies. Okay, so check those out in the shop. All right, so one of the things that we do each month is there in the Quilted Joy Clubhouse, we put out a call for folks to post a photograph of an unquilted quilt top. And then I select one and show you how I would quilt it if it were my quilt. And we have so much feedback from folks who say they really love this portion of our meeting because it kind of gets you to see how another person takes a quilt and breaks it down and thinks through what would go where so that you can kind of visualize it yourself so that the next time you have a quilt and you're trying to figure out what the heck to put on it, it should be a little bit easier to kind of break it down. So, Rhonda, you posted this and I fell in love with it. I don't know what the name of the pattern is, Rhonda. If you would post that in the clubhouse so that if other people are looking for this, they can find it. But there's so much to enjoy about Rhonda's quilt. One of the things I want you to notice is that she used fabrics that will allow the quilting to show. So if you are interested in kind of showing off your quilting, choose your fabrics appropriately so that the work you put into it will pay off. Okay, so Rhonda, the first thing that I saw here was I really started to see this kind of medallion quilt emerge with what you posted. And so the first thing I wanted to do with it was kind of create bones on the quilt so that I could kind of break this space down into smaller chunks. And so what I thought, what I wanted to do here is I wanted to take the medallion shape here. So there's a straight line from there and I'm gonna go up to there and down to there. Over, let's see, I think I clicked a little bit. It's hard this far out, but I just want you to see where that medallion takes place. Okay, so, and then we ended here. Okay, so let me zoom in a little bit so that you can see that a little bit better. And I am using a mouse that's in the shape of a tablet so that I can just sort of see a little bit better. Or draw a little bit better. So there's that medallion shape that started to emerge. And the other thing I started to notice, Rhonda, is that this unit here, is the same unit as this unit here, right? It's just in a different colorway. And so I started to look at, like, how could I pull those two together to bring that out. And so when I started to look at this medallion and I thought, you know, if I cut through this with a straight line, it's gonna break that into a piece. And what I'd really love to do is kind of bring out these applique tulip shapes and kind of mimic this applique tulip shape into these spaces. So I'm actually gonna show you the way that I broke this space down into bones. So instead of going through that, let me zoom in a little bit. Instead of going through that flower space, instead of going through it with a line of stitching, I just use the piecing to extend the line out to create that medallion shape. And then there's a straight line here to give me a sense of where my spine is going to be for my flowers. So I'm gonna put flowers in this area. Let's see. I'm gonna put flowers in this area and in this area so that they are the same. And then I'm gonna put leaves in this area and this area. So it's gonna be basically right side up, upside down. I just wanna zoom out so that you can see those bones that I put on, just that you can see that medallion shape that I created without going through the areas I'm gonna use for my flowers. All right, I'm gonna zoom back in and I'm gonna move over so you can see things a little bit better. So take a look at this applique shape. Do you see how it has these outside petal parts here? Right, and then the interior starts with a central plume, and then there's one on each side of it. And you take a look at the shape of these leaves. They're kind of like C curves to make the leaves. So anything that I can do to kind of mimic and pull the voice of the quilt together by bringing the applique shapes into the quilting, I'm gonna take advantage of that. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just do one of my, those kind of C leaves, and then I'm gonna go up and I'm just gonna do a curl in and I'm gonna head back. And then I'm gonna do another C leaf and a curl in and head back. And now I'm gonna head up to this main flower area, and I'm gonna do a skinny point. I'm gonna do that one side of my tulip, and then just to get back down, I'm gonna actually put two. So it'll be a little bit different than the applique, but I needed that to give me room. Okay, and now I'm gonna do this side, and if you need to, Rhonda, you could like create a wax paper, freezer paper template, where you basically outline that and then trace if it makes you nervous to do that freehand. But by the time you get all these on here, all of the variations are gonna add some interest. You gotta remember, we're not computers, right? I'm a computerized quilter. I love my computer. I love to stitch with it, but you can't compare yourself to that computer because, you know, there's soul and a human touch to what you're doing. Okay, so I've done it in the same area. Now we're gonna go up here. And we're gonna put the same motif where I come down and think skinny thoughts, come up to this side of the tulip, head back over, come down, on this side of the tulip, head back over, come down. Now I'm doing my side leaves. And there you go. All right, so I would repeat that in all these different areas, right? You've got pairs in all these different areas. Let me zoom out so you can see all the different pairs. So we're gonna repeat that in all these different pairs all around the quilt. And then what I wanna do is I wanna think about that applique shape a little bit more. And what I would do in this applique shape, because I wanna really make this medallion-y kind of, where I'm carving it out of your borders, I really wanna make that obvious. So what I thought I would do is first trace around the applique, and that will define the area. And I would actually go in here and trace, I don't know about that center, but I certainly would trace around the outside edge of that leaf. Now, if you are quilting for others, it's a conversation you need to have. You need to say, is it okay if I stitch on your applique? Because they need to know that's gonna happen and not be surprised that you're stitching over their applique. So I didn't stitch on that middle portion. I might, it depends on the size. I can't really tell the size, but I'm gonna outline both of these appliques to give them some definition and to allow the batting to kind of fill this space and bring it towards the eye. And then in that background, I'm just gonna do a simple meander. And the key is, I would make it fairly small, but in this case, I'm gonna make it big just so that I can fill the space. Do you see I'm crossing over? Don't panic, you're gonna love how this looks. I have carved out basically a new border that is gonna carve out a new shape And one of the things that why this works is because of the fabric you chose, Rhonda, because it will allow the quilting to shine. The fabrics shine on their own, but sometimes if you choose a busy fabric, you don't get these opportunities to carve out new space. So we're gonna just keep going, just a basic meander, and I'm gonna stay now in the white. And what I could do here is when I get close, if I didn't wanna go around, you know, the applique and then restart, is just when I got close to the applique, I would trace around it and then I would continue on with this filler as I go, so I don't have to do too many stops and starts. And when we talk about our magic portals, do you notice that right here would be a magic portal where I could jump in to both my flowers and this background space? All right, I'm gonna zoom out and I just want you to see how that kind of carves the space out and creates that medallion. It comes forward. All right, I'm gonna turn that off and I'm gonna show you now, there's my flowers and I thought, there we go. And so there's that background filler. So do you see how it gives you that whole diamond shape that comes forward? The one thing I didn't talk about was what I did in that Lemoyne star area. So let's take a look at that. I'm gonna actually turn that layer off so that you can, there we go. So let's zoom into one of these Lemoyne stars because it was just a super simple way to treat these Lemoyne stars. So all I did is I came up with a curl, came back, and went up into a point and came back down. And then I reversed it so that it makes like a heart in that space. Now we had talked last month about diamonds, a diamond grid. So I want you to notice these are diamonds. So if you wanted to use the diamond grid that we talked about last month, you certainly could. But by having these face in opposite directions, I can create these little, they kind of create hearts where they come together. Okay, so let me zoom out and I'm gonna show you again that Lemoyne star. I'm gonna zoom out again. Okay, so here we go. We've got our applique outlined. We've got our meander to force the eye to see this on point medallion. And we've done our Lemoyne star. Okay, so let's talk about this outer sashing here. I'm gonna zoom in. We'll just zoom into this corner. So this outer sashing here. So it's the same fabric as our Lemoyne star, but if I just continued on with that meander, it would get a little muddy. So instead, what I'm gonna do first is I am going to, hold on, I already showed you, didn't I? There you go. So I'm just gonna, first I'm gonna carve this space out by doing some stitch in the ditch. And then I'm gonna go through and just do some curls. I'm gonna curl this way, and then I'm gonna curl this way. I just want something kind of flowy and flowery, and I want you to notice how this calls back to not only the Lemoyne star, that curl that I put in the Lemoyne star, but it also calls back to the curve that I used in those petals of our flowers, in the leaves of our flowers, I should say. All right, I'm gonna pick up a little bit of speed here and I'm gonna head down. And it's just a back and forth curl. All right, and so that would go all the way around, Rhonda, and I'm gonna show you what that looks like. So there's our outer sashing. All right, so then what I thought was those Lemoyne stars look kind of lonely to me. Like they just need a little bit of something, something. So what I thought is if I went into those Lemoyne stars to kind of frame them out and just did some straight line, let's do, to frame out that Lemoyne star. Pretty simple, but it's super effective. Take a look at how that kind of frames everything out, and I'm gonna zoom out so you can see. So when I frame out your Lemoyne stars, let's go up. It just kind of gives them a location to live, and I just really like that look. If you wanted to, you could put a background filler in here now, but I think it might get too busy. And then that center, it was a little empty. So for that center, I went through and just did an on point and then used that same kind of curled portion that we use the leaves, the same kind of curled frond here in the center of the quilt. All right, Rhonda, so that left this outside border. And I really don't want to, you know, there's a lot going on. I don't want to take away from it. I just need something to kind of calmly frame it. And so if I'm going to go into a quadrant so you can see this a little bit better. What I thought was I can use the bones of the quilt to give myself a frame that will kind of calm things down. So I'm going to use the piecing here. And I'm going to actually go, I'm going to show you how I thought about it. So I went from here. There we go. So I went from here to here, and this is not the order I stitched it in. I just wanted you to see how I thought about it. And then from here to here and here to here. So first I thought, well, I can break this space down using the piecing, and then I want to go in between this. In the halfway point in between this. And then I want to use these areas here. And then I thought one more right here, one more right here. And that would frame out that quilt. And then once I know where my lines are, then I can start to stitch them in one continuous path. So I'm going to show you that. So there you go, Rhonda. That would be how the quilt would look with that outside border, and it kind of depends on the size of these blocks. It's hard for me to tell. You may want to increase the number of these piano key lines to frame that out, but this would be absolutely beautiful, and I hope that you kind of saw how I broke it down. There's going to be some times where you would need to break your threads. Don't let that disturb you. It's just life. So I've tried to give you kind of a sense of how to do the majority of it in one continuous path, but you probably will have to break your threads a couple of times. So there you go, Rhonda. Now, Rhonda, you quilt your quilt however you want to quilt it, but be sure to post a photo of it in the clubhouse because we would love to see what you come up with. But hopefully that was helpful for you to see how kind of how I would think through a quilt and create new space using the applique as a launching off point to the quilting I would put on the quilt. All right, so we have had some really wonderful posts over the last month of in our clubhouse of what people are working on. And so I just wanna kind of brag and show you what people are doing in the clubhouse. And the clubhouse is full of just the kindest, nicest, most supportive quilters around. And so I want you to see this. This was what we looked at last month. I selected Pat's quilt and showed how I would quilt it for my quilt. And then she did it. She quilted it the way that I suggested. So it has that icy flow over her quilt top. Really beautiful. Pat, thank you so much for posting that. And then Renee, she posted this one. She said that this one had some fullness that she had to deal with and that she used feathers to kind of control that fullness. And then if you look closely in her sashing spaces, she used our Ladybug, a grid design to work through those sashing spaces. And Carol actually loved this quilt so much, she made it twice. And the one on the right that you see there, she used a Baptist fan design, both all over the quilt. And then for the one on the left, when she made it the second time, she just used that Baptist fan design on the bottom half of the cross and then did some rays coming out of the cross, so the top half of the cross. So really beautiful job, Carol. Thank you for posting it. And Missy, now take a look. She posted a photo of her new machine, and it still has the red bow on the top of it, don't you? Love that. So she's quilting with her red bow on it. But Missy posted that she's her first quilts, and the one on the left there is a panel that she had a whole lot of fun with, and then the one on the right is a star sampler quilt that she's got loaded to go. And she actually then posted photos of what she did on this. So hop over to the clubhouse to see some other shots of that quilt. And then Mary Ann posted this photo of her octopus. And this is one of those, thank you, flew out of my head. Laura Heine collage quilts, that's the octopus, and I forgot what the name of this one is, but Marianne did this one in a grid. So just straight lines, left, right, straight lines, vertical and horizontal, and it's just a great treatment. And don't you love all the little jellyfish family that's down there in the lower right having a little party, and she's just got little fish just sprinkled all over. I could look at that for a while, Marianne. Thank you for posting. And then Deb posted this one. She used our feather pantograph that we recently highlighted in a video on YouTube. So if you're looking for tutorials on long arm quilting and pantograph quilting, head over to our YouTube channel for more tutorials. But Deb used one of those on her quilt. Beautiful job, Deb. And Carol posted this one. It is a panel, and then she added those circles around with the giraffe print and the antelope print. Gotta love that. And then of course one of them has a heart on it. So I always laugh. Look, the quilt has feet. I always look at the feet, right? The tiger has feet. It's so cute. Thanks, Carol. And then Pat loves to hand dye her fabric, and this was a mandala that she dyed. And then she used all of those concepts that we've been talking about. And Pat used to come in and rent here. And so we've, played around a lot with custom designs with Pat, and she kind of brought everything that we've been talking about together into one quilt. And Pat, I'm just so darn proud of you. You've just done such a great job. I mean, look at that flower feather that she's got in those spaces, and how she kind of carved out new space within her hand-dyed panel there. Just beautiful, Pat. And Michelle, she said this will probably be the only applique quilt that she does. I guess she didn't enjoy it too much, but I wanted to direct you to what she added, a little Easter egg that she added. Do you see the M there in the right-hand photo in the bottom right-hand corner of the green space? So she had all these pebbles, and then she put her initial on there. Sweet touch, Michelle, good job. And Terry, look at you go. So Terry posted this, where she's taken these diamond shapes, and she's created spines for feathers on one half, and then used kind of a chevron straight line ruler work in the other. And Terry's been posting photos of these as she goes, each portion of her quilt as she goes. So thank you so much for posting those, Terry. It's been interesting and fun to see your quilt as it progresses. And then Virginia, this is what I was talking to you guys about at the top of the of our meeting. So Virginia used her ladybug. Do you see the ladybug? Love it. She put little Easter egg fabrics in here. So I'm sure that Virginia didn't add that just because we've been talking about ladybugs, but I just thought it was so cute. So she took that hexie shape, and she did a grid design moving through her hexies, and one of those was a ladybug. And then the other thing I thought was super cool, so take a look at the tablecloth that table runner is sitting on top of. So she says that every time they have somebody over for dinner, they ask them to sign the tablecloth. And so that's like their special company's coming tablecloth. And they can go through and reminisce about all the people they've had gathered around their family table over the years, because they ask everybody to sign it. Isn't that sweet? What a sweet idea, Virginia. Really sweet. All right, well, thank you guys so much for posting, and I would love to see what you're working on. So head over to the Quilted Joy Clubhouse and post a photo over there on Facebook. And don't forget that you can find us on our Facebook page, the Quilted Joy Facebook page, and you can also find us over on Instagram at Quilted Joy over on Instagram. And then don't forget, we're on YouTube as well, where we post videos and tutorials for you. And of course, you can always join us at quiltedjoy.com and enjoy our blog and other fun things that we have. But be sure you're signed up for that newsletter, because the newsletter will have a lot of extra worksheets and things that'll support you as you kind of learn more about grid quilting. So next month in August, Wednesday, August the 4th at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific, we're going to talk about how to use grids with clamshells. So clamshells is, a traditional quilting pattern, and clamshells are a grid design. And so we're going to look at ways to kind of manipulate clamshells by using grids. You're going to enjoy it. It's another great way to break down space. So I appreciate you joining me today. I know you have a lot of choices about where to spend your time, and I appreciate you spending a little time with me. And I will see you guys in the clubhouse, all right? Okay, see you later.